gotta keep it strong. Move along like I know you do. And even when your hope is gone, move along, just to make it through. When all you gotta keep is strong, move along like I know you do. And even when your hope is gone, move along, just to make it through. When all you gotta keep is strong, move along like I know you do.
You're sitting at a red light. You're not the first one there, but you're the second. And you've got places to go. You've got people to see. The light turns green. Can anybody explain to me what green means?
Go.
There are moments when the person in front of you decides that there are better things than to follow the green. People get feeling the spirit. There may be texting. They may be checking their Facebook status, whatever the case may be. They may kind of just spaced off. They might have had a bad morning. But whatever the case may be, there's that moment where you kind of pause and you go, if you're a normal, rational human being, is you pause and give them a moment. But at some point, you debate, when is too soon to hit my horn? Because I need to be able to get this person to move. You may even contemplate, if they don't move, to maybe switch lanes and then begin to go in another direction around them if they don't move. Because when we get to a light and it is green, that means to go. See, in life, we have a lot of moments where we are called to move from the place that we're at. From the place that we find ourselves, that at some point and sometime, and it happens in stages throughout life, that where we are can't be the place that we stay. Now, I'm not always talking about a physical location. There are times in life as we get through, you know, the same thing that you did when you were a baby, you're not doing now. Like, right? Like, we have restrooms. The same things that you did as a kid where you're running around and just acting crazy, you don't, well, some of you don't do that now. As you get older, and you begin to walk through things, the way that you acted then and the way that you act now should be a reflection of the fact that you and I have stages of life, and the stages of life that we're in change. But God, in His infinite wisdom, because He created us, because He made us for more, and many times, oftentimes, and this is the case in my own life, and I know that it's the case in many of your lives, because we have this wrestling. We settle, and we talked about this last week, we settle for something less than what God designed us for. And so we wanted to talk and take 4 weeks to really dive into what God wants for you and I in the mission of the church. In like Tommy said, and this is true, that church isn't something that we come to. The church is something that we make up. You and I and all of the people and all the kids back there who are screaming their heads off for God, which is so awesome. If you ever get a chance to go back there, they put us to shame. And watching the way they move and interact. And God took us together to be the church, and us as the church and individually and then together are called to move together and move in a direction that honors God and that helps other people to find Him. Or as we put it at forefront, to be people helping people to find and follow Jesus. And there's intentionality behind why we talk about those things, because it's very important that we not stay where we've been. Because when we choose to just sit and not jump into the adventure that God has for us, we can begin to lose sight of the beauty of God's church and the beauty of what happens. And I'll tell you what, if you are new today, I am so thankful that you're here. This is one of those weeks that you and I both need. Whether you're close to God or far from Him, we all need a chance for someone behind us, when they see that we're not taking action in life and we're not moving, to honk the horn, maybe sometimes give a little meep meep, sometimes to lay it on, to shake us out of where we are, because God doesn't want us to stay there. And as a church at Forefront Church, we believe that God has something much greater for us than just simply doing the same thing that we've always done. That's why things will change. That's why we'll introduce new songs. That's why things will happen here. Every once in a while, we'll put the sermon at the beginning just to throw all of you guys off. Be like, I showed up and I don't like to sing, and now he's preaching. That means I'm going to have to sing at the end. And like throw up. We will change it. The way we do ministry. That's why we've done ministry in an open bar, and we were chastised by other churches for a couple of years. They're like, you can't have church in an open bar. You'd be like, you mean like how Jesus went and was known as a drunkard because he hung out with people that drank and did all that stuff? You mean we can't do that? Like the example of Jesus, okay. Like we decide, and we will try, and the way we put it here as a staff and as leaders, that we will do anything short of sin to see people far from God come to know Him. And so as we look at the mission of being people helping people, that means that there's action in what we do, that your life and my life help other people along to find Jesus and then to follow Him. Because we'll have people that will say that Forefront, that's like a beginner church. Like, and then like once, and I've heard this from people, and especially it's usually people who are church, that will say like, well, that's a beginner church and I need to go deeper in my faith. And we noted this last week, that there's nothing deeper than Jesus. And so I don't really know what to say to that, except there's nothing deeper than Jesus. That everything, that my joy and your joy and everything that encapsulates, and we try to make it difficult, but it's not. And so how do you and I fall on our faces before Him and surrender to Him, and then, as we begin to find that joy, help other people do that? And we want to take some time to say that we are not just going to sit in where we are, but we're going to move forward. And how do we live out that mission? How do we live lives that echo God, that look at the life and teachings of Jesus and say, I want to live in that in my school? For those of you guys who are in middle school and high school, my heart breaks for you and the challenges that you have. Because unlike any other generation in history, you are facing a culture that is more difficult maybe than it's ever been to get through the noise, to help people see the need for Jesus, and honestly, there's so much pushback against the idea of God and faith. And adults, as we see our neighbors, as we see our friends, that the idea of God has kind of fallen to the wayside. And so how do you and I live out that mission wholeheartedly? And you might be thinking, if you're new and you haven't claimed faith, like, I don't even know about living out the mission because I don't even know about God yet. Well, the good news is that we're all going to kind of journey together today, and that we can take the precepts that we're going to talk about today and apply them in our lives to seek after God, whether we're new to faith or we've been at this a while, because all of us need and have another step in the journey, because none of us have arrived. If you feel like you've arrived, you're in the wrong place. Or maybe better yet, you're in the right place. Because we're going to help drive home that idea that none of us have, and that we all have a ways to go. And so I'm excited for today. If you have a Bible, I'd love for you to turn over to Psalm 42. Psalm 42, it's in the Old Testament of the Bible. And we give away Bibles for free. We talk about this all the time at the Get Connected table in the lobby. You can grab those. You can also download an easy-to-read translation of the Bible. There's a Bible app. Just search Bible app and you can find it. And I want to make note of this briefly, but you can download the Forefront Church app. And we are, if you have the old one, then there's good news. We have a new one. We're changing things around a little bit. And so if you search for Forefront Church app, you want to download the one that's all lime green with the white circle, and then you'll open it up, and it'll have all these little circles, has all kinds of stuff. But the reason that I say this is because if you're like, man, I don't know my way around the Bible, every week when you come in and you open this app up, it's going to go directly to the passage that we're talking about. And so you open up the little Bible thing in there, it'll go straight to it. And we have notes that you're able to take and do that. And we want to make sure that there's no way that you don't have an opportunity to engage God, engage your faith. And so there's a couple things in there that'd be really helpful for you, and you're able to do that and share that with friends. And so we're slowly phasing out the old one, and we're moving into this new one. I really like it. There's a digital connection card and other things in there. We just really want to make sure that we're able to help you in the best way possible. And so we want to put that in your pocket, so you're able to have everything that you need. And each week the message notes will be in there and you'll be able to engage some different things. But we love technology here, and we figure if you're using it already, why not embrace that? And so you could download that app and it has everything in there for you as well. And I want to look at this passage in Psalm, because if we're going to be people helping people to find and follow Jesus, if that is the mission here at Forefront Church, we have to understand what gets us there. And that's for all of us, no matter where we fall and where we're from, and so what we've done, what we've been through. And so I want to read a little bit. And so if you have a Bible, again, Psalm 42. If not, we will have it here on the screen, and you can grab one afterwards, and that would be awesome. And so you guys ready? You guys are excited. I like it. Psalm 42, we cannot stay here. Verse 1. As the deer pants for streams of water, so my soul pants for you, my God. Kind of right into the thick of it, looking in and seeing that we want to be people who chase after, who yearn after, who want to follow God. Verse 2, my soul thirsts for God, for the living God. When can I go and meet with God? Again, this whole soul thirst. And I don't know if you've ever been thirsty before. Like, really, I'm not talking about like, oh, I'm feeling a little, can I get some more water at the table? Like, thirsty, you have worked hard. You've gone through that workout. You feel that, and you are like, if I don't get water, it is going to be bad for me. Just feeling like on the verge of death. And that's all that could sustain me, thirsty. My tears have been my food day and night, while people say to me all day long, where is your God? These things I remember as I pour out my soul. You see, there's this in the beginning, it's saying like, listen, I thirst for you, I wanna be this way. But it says, listen, I remember how I used to go to the house of God. See, the writer here is lamenting, is saddened, because it's like, listen, I want to be that way, but listen, I remember when and you're starting to get this sense that you used to be one way, but now you're not. I used to go to the house of God under the protection of the Mighty One with shouts of joy and praise among the festive throng. Verse 5, why, my soul, are you downcast? We start getting a picture here of what's happening. Why so disturbed within me? We get this picture that's being painted that something is not right. And we desire, our goal is to be people helping people to find and follow Jesus, that my heart would be after God. But he says, listen, it's downcast, there's something wrong within me. Put your hope in God, for I will yet praise him, my Savior and my God. Verse 6, my soul is downcast within me, therefore I will remember who? You. I will remember you from the land of the Jordan. It starts remembering things. You ever been in a situation where you get down and then you start remembering the good things? Maybe you lost a loved one. Maybe there's a situation that's gone south with a friendship, and you start remembering some of the joyous times, the things that really just well up inside you about what you loved about that person, and situations that are wonderful, and all of these things. This person's looking back on it and beginning to look at seeing, like, all right, I am remembering you from the land of Jordan. It starts noting some of the things that that happened with God from the land of the Jordan, from the heights of the Hermon, from the Mount Mizar in verse 7, and this is where we're going to kind of sit. Deep calls to deep. In the roar of your waterfalls, all of your waves and breakers have swept over me. In a beach town, we can get this context. Whereas somebody in the Midwest, it would be a little more difficult. That as we go down to the oceanfront and we stand in the breaking of the waves, and as things begin to rush over us, and sometimes even when it begins to pull you in, as deep calls to deep in the roar of your waterfalls and all of your waves and breakers have swept over me. I want to look at what it means to live out the mission when it comes to a character that is rich and deep within you and I. Before we do that, why don't you pray with me this morning? God, I thank you for today, and thank you for the time that we're going to have this morning to share and learn about you. But all of us come from different backgrounds. All of us are in different places in life. There's some of us this morning that got awful news. There's some of us this morning that are having an amazing day. There's some of us that are just frustrated with life and we don't know what to do, while others feel like today's just a pretty good day. And as we search and as we wrestle with life and as we ask these big questions about our meaning here and not wanting to stay where we're at, and we're getting shaken out of it with the sound of your celestial horn moving us forward, let us hear it. Let us turn down the music in the car. Let us parse away all the other distractions and hear you this morning. It's through Jesus we pray all these things. Amen. When we ask this question about living the mission and being people, as we read passages as deep calls to deep, as this motion takes place of us saying, you know, that my life is rich, is full. And I'm not talking about rich like money, that there's, you know, just this amazing passion and excitement and joy in God, that deep calls to deep. I wonder, and I ask this question of myself too, what is your primary influence? If we're going to be people that live out a mission and follow God, what's your primary influence? And really there's two things that influence us for the most part. It's the culture that we find ourselves in, or it's the kingdom. Now, I'm not talking about swords and castles and conquering and braveheart and freedom and these type of things. I'm talking about the king. This here is part of the kingdom of God. The heaven is part of the kingdom of God. His joy, the church universal and other churches that are meeting and celebrating and doing these things are part of the kingdom of God. And I wonder what our influence is. And I ask this question to myself too, is what is influencing my life? Is it the people around me, the opinions that they have, the things that go on, how they comment on my social networking and what my wife will say to me or what someone thinks about whatever, that what is forming and moving and influencing you as an individual? Is it the culture around you, or is it the kingdom of God in the movement that he has? And there's really, when we want to get to the goal of being people, helping people to find and follow Jesus, and these things are influencing us, there's sometimes where we may want to take a shortcut in the process that God has for us. And I don't know about you when you were maybe in school, but for me, when the teacher said, we need to get to X, no matter what class it was in, my thought initially was, in every instance, what are the least amount of steps taken to get to X? And I want to do that. Why? Because you might have been the person that enjoys the, I enjoy the process. I'm thankful for you. For me, it was always, if I can go all around and get to X, or I can go and get to X, I want to do that. Now, in culture, in the way that God works in refining our character and having these two different influences, some of us sometimes would choose what I call, and you may be wondering why we're getting there. No, there is no candy in this at all. I would say that there's one choice that people have is that there's kind of this pinata lifestyle, right? We couldn't fit that one in here today. This pinata lifestyle, and you've been around, if you haven't been around pinata, and we, for most part, when we do birthday parties around our house, we will, especially when it's nice outside, we will do the pinata, and we don't do like the, everybody pull a string, like we get the ones that you fill, and then you hang, and then you move the rope around, you blindfold somebody, you spin them, and then you give them a stick that could maim somebody, and then you swing, and swing, and swing, and you beat this thing until eventually it breaks open, and what? Candy, goodies, amazing. And then everyone loses their minds. Everyone turns and adjust. They go nuts and they get as much as they have. And this lifestyle is much like what most of us want to experience. We go, what are the least amount of steps that I can take to be somebody who can find and follow Jesus and get a quick fix? And here's what happens. Because I've watched it happen, you know, it with myself, with kids and other stuff. We get this, and this is, it's exciting, it's fun, it's short-lived, and it always ends up in a sugar crash, and it leaves a deeper void than was ever before. But it's fun, and it fills that moment. But then there's another type of life, and I don't know if you've ever seen a photo of these, but there's more of an iceberg lifestyle. Now, they're not a whole lot to look at from the surface. And sometimes people go, man, that's kind of cool, whatever, but the beauty lies in the depth at which the iceberg goes down. And the beauty is in what took place over the course of a long time to build up to a place where this can be seen. That didn't just happen overnight with a stick and candy and twirling around. There is a life that we get to choose between. Is I want to be someone who finds and follows Jesus. I want to be someone that deep calls out to deep, that my life calls out to others. But we have a choice in that of choosing a pinata life, a just get it done quick, that leads to emptiness, that leads to quick results that usually don't yield a whole lot of depth within them, or beginning to search after and go, how, if God's calling me to this, how can I do that? We've likened this in past messages to a microwave versus a crock pot. And for many of you today, you probably have a crock pot going as we speak to watch Cam Newton win. And this is the life that we can choose, either quick fix that doesn't yield results, or how do I get this over time? Because this is a journey. It's the sprint versus the marathon. How do I get to a place like that? And I love what Richard Foster says. He's a professor, and he shares it this way here, and it'll be on the screen, that superficiality is the curse of our age. The doctrine of instant satisfaction is a primary spiritual problem. It says the desperate need today is not for a greater number of intelligent people or gifted people, but for what? Deep people. And I love that he frames it this way, because for most of us within our context, when we hear deep, whether it be a theologian, a philosopher, we immediately go to what? Head knowledge. We immediately go there. And he's saying, listen, that's not what frames out the course of deep, not a greater number of intelligent people or gifted people. So he's not referencing this. And I wrote down in my notes, passage says, depth is about character, not knowledge. Our depth within being and living out the mission is not about knowledge, it's about character. A bold character is built through habits that reinforce Jesus and the mission. And I know we hear habits and we go, usually we hear habits and we think about them in a negative light. Oh, I want to be somebody who finds and follows Jesus. But man, I don't even know if God would love me because I have bad habits. I don't know if God would accept someone like me because I just can't follow through because I have a tendency to do blank. And if we want to be someone, if we want to be people, to live out that mission, then we have to get an understanding of what it means when God calls us to the depths and having a life that can be seen by people, but it takes the groundwork underneath, the marathon, the crock pot, to make that life happen. Or we would maybe put it this way for you and I, is that if we desire to be deep in character, which I don't think anybody walks up and goes, I don't really care about people think about my character. I think for most of us, we would say that I want my character to be reflective of one that people would go, man, there's something about that guy or that gal, that there's something that's different about you, that people would trust you, that they would want to honor you. And so as we look at this, if you desire to be deep in character, the rhythm of your habits will change. If that's your desire. Because if, say, listen, man, I want to have great character, but I'm just not going to change. No, that doesn't happen. We're on the just hours away from amazing champions. Whether you like either team or not, like, they are champions. They beat out everyone else to be there. They did that because their habits changed and reflected their desire to win a game. And when you and I want to live on mission, when we want to fulfill what God has for us, man, I want to share love with other people. I want to share grace. I want to share truth with people. I want them to encounter God. Then we have to be able to say, I have a desire for my character to change. But the only way that that can happen is the rhythm of my habits will change in the way that this happens. And I wrote this down in my notes and kind of scribbled it on here, is that we need to be seeking God void of noise. Show of hands, how many of you guys believe that your life has a little more noise than you would like? Yeah. Man, I feel the same way. Like, if I take hands and feet, I would put them all up, but then that would look weird. Like, I wish that my life had less clutter and less noise in it. And so when I'm trying for my character, for your characters, we're seeking this. We say, God, I want to follow you, that the rhythm of my habits need to change, but they don't change until we get intentional. Until we say, I want my life to change, and so I have to take steps to do that. And that is very hard. But Jesus modeled this. Jesus was fantastic at this. In his life, in the beginning, the bookends of his life echoed habits of change. In the very beginning of his ministry, he goes to the temple. The very beginning of his ministry, goes to the temple, and it won't be on the screen, but it'll be here. It said, he went to the synagogue as was his custom. That this was something that would happen on a regular basis. And at the end of his ministry, it says that he went out to pray at the Mount of Olives, this place where he prayed, as usual. In both of those instances, in going to the synagogue, as was custom, and then at the end of his ministry, a few years later, before he went to the cross, that he went there as usual. Both of those instances have this word, the New Testament of the Bible, and these passages were written in Greek. And that word there is ethos in both of those instances, which means habits. You see, Jesus had a rhythm of healthy habits to model it. Jesus didn't get up one day and go, hey, everybody, love one another, do all that stuff, and not live it. He didn't wake up one day and say, hey, I need you to go help other people learn about me and share my truth and baptize people and love on them and care for them and then not echo it in his own life. You see, Jesus set the parameters of what it looked like for you and I to have habits and healthy ways in him. And so when we look at his life and we see these things, and when we look at that verse, when deep calls to deep, and I have this thing that I write down a lot in like different notes, and when I read these verses, is, and I wrote it down in here, is that I can't bring people to what I haven't gone to first. I can't give away what I don't have. And so when we say, I want to help people meet Jesus, but oftentimes we want to help people meet somebody that we don't quite follow. And so how do we live on mission is that we have to be able to say, God's calling deep to deep. And so what does it mean for my life to clear away the noise and hear him void of all of the extra stuff? Well, Jesus set the tone for that. And it's in this passage in Matthew, and it'll be here on the screen. Matthew 6, verses 16 through 18 says, when you fast, we're going to get to what fast means. When you fast, do not look somber as the hypocrites do. And he assumes that you're going to do this. This isn't like, if you choose to, he says, when you fast, do not look somber as the hypocrites do, for they disfigure their faces to show others they are fasting. Truly, I tell you, they have received their reward in full. But when you fast, put on oil on your head and wash your face so that it will not be obvious to others that you are fasting, but only to your Father who is unseen, and your Father, God above, who sees what's done in secret, will reward you. Fasting simply is the practice of giving up something so that you can have a void in which you hear God, to focus on him. Now, I know immediately, and you might hear this, especially since the practice of and the time of Lent is coming up, you'll see people doing this, and people will get on, especially on social networking, and they'll let everybody know, oh, I'm giving up my Starbucks, and they'll let you know every day, like, the struggle's real, it's so hard, and all this, and it's like you've given up coffee. You didn't, like, you're not getting whipped and tased every day. And so there's these, and so we walk through this. And so what is fasting is giving up something to reflect and connect with God. And Jesus was setting the tone for this because Jesus did this. Before he started his ministry, he went for 40 days. And this is the practice of Lent is reflective of what Jesus did. Before he started his ministry, he went into the wilderness for 40 days and just no food, just water, you know, just like just going nothing. Like, I'm going to be and just sit with God. And he was tempted by Satan during this time. And he said, listen, I can give you all this, and gives him all these temptations. And every time, Jesus sets a cool example, and you can go back and look at this in Luke, is that every single time Jesus answers him with scripture, with the Bible. He says, listen, you know, every time he answers him and he fights him back. And so if you're ever in an instance where things are hard and whatever, there's a beautiful premise of what Jesus sets the example of going to the Bible. And he gets done with this whole thing, this whole 40 days, and he starts his ministry. But I love the way that he starts it because it says in there, and again, it won't be on the screen, but it says, when he returned in power of spirit. Now, most of us, when we say we want to give something up, we're like, I am not going to be more powerful after this. Like right now, like in last week, I said, you know, I'm giving up soda. I'm going to get rid of red meat. Like, I'm not going to have certain stuff. Like, I still, there are days where, like, you know, the mind is willing, but the flesh is weak. I just want something, you know, just like, want it. And we think if I give something up, that how am I going to be stronger? And Jesus sets this amazing example for you and I about this practice. And honestly, I want to challenge us as Forefront Church is that Lent starts on Wednesday, and then it goes for 40 days. And there, I know there's some, as soon as I say this, there's some of us that go like, I don't want to fast. I want to slow. Like, I want to, like, just do, right? Like, I don't want to do anything. And I know, and this is especially for, like, the OCD people. You're like, no, not ready. Like, it starts Wednesday. Like, I wasn't prepared for this. Like, I need to get look at a book, and I need to read up on stuff, and I need to do whatever. Slow down. I'm with you. It's going to be okay. As we hear this and we see this and we want to move through this, is what does it mean to practice the art? And what I'm not going to do is I'm not this morning going to tell you, here are the things that you need to give up. I'm not going to give any examples. And if you're like thinking about it right now and moving through your head, I want to caution you, and I want to talk about three real aspects very quickly about three real aspects about fasting and what it can do for you and I so that we can hear from God, void of the noise. The first one is this, as we begin in aspects of fasting, creating space for God to speak. Now, for most of us, what we do is we think of things like right now, when we say this, like, and there's not going to be like a commitment card and all this. We're challenging our community from Wednesday for 40 days to give up something to hear God clearly so we can beckon him to bring us into the depths that only he does. But when we see this and create space for God to speak, usually what we do is you're thinking through it now, you're like, all right, I can give up this, and I can give up that, whatever. That's actually the antithesis of what God calls to do. For some of us, you're gonna get to Wednesday and you're gonna be like, I have no idea what to do. I don't even know. And you're like, I would much rather you spend the first 10 days of that sitting and talking to God. Just asking, God, what is it that you want me to do? Because for some of us, there's this control that is, I want to be a person that finds and that finds Jesus, helps other people find him, and move forward so they can follow him. And we want to control every aspect. I'm going to get them to church, and then they're going to go to my small group, and then we're going to do this, and then they're going to get baptized, and I'm going to do it, and then they're going to reach their husband and then their kids, and then I'm going to have a badge, and you know, like, we do all this stuff, and it's like, at what point do we say, God, I want to open up and just hear you, not talk, not convince you of what I want to do, but create space so that you and I can hear him clearly. It might be that we start on Wednesday and you have a 3-day fast and you have another 37 days of talking with God, but those 3 days are going to rival anything that you've ever done before because you took 37 days to go, God, I have no idea. I've never done this before. And I keep asking you and I'm not have clarity. And then it hits and you're going to hit 3 days and you're just going to go, oh my gosh. People are going to be like, what's wrong with you? God's been doing some stuff in my life. And what happened? Because we want to search after him. We want to do these things, but then we don't create the space. And what fasting does is it brings us to a place where we feel it. Like for some of us, we go, yeah, like I gave the instance of coffee, just being silly. But like for some of you, if you gave coffee, it would not impact you at all. There has to be a place where we say, what is it? God led in creating that space for him to speak. For some of us, we never get quiet enough to ever hear him speak. The second real-time aspect of fasting is seeing a clear picture of his purpose. That we go like, man, I'm able to see what God has in store for me. And I say this, not the purpose that you think is really great and you've asked him to come along in the journey. Like the thing you're like, this is totally what my purpose is. You're good with that, right, God? You've done this. I know my kids do this. They're like, Daddy, like we totally need to go to that like trampoline, jump, hop, break a leg place, right? And they're not asking for my permission. They're actually trying to convince me of what they desire. And this creates this clear picture and seeing it because for some of us, we've never seen the picture of that. We just kind of jump into that and it might look crazy. You might hate your spouse in your house right now, and you're going to sit for 10, 12, 13 days, and all of a sudden God's going to go, here is your purpose, and here's how you're going to fast, and what you're going to be, and he's going to say, listen, I actually want to get you to fast from being awful to your spouse. And you're going to go, I don't like that at all, because they're awful, and I need to let them know. And then all of a sudden, as he begins to unpack that, what's going to happen is you're going to see a change in your own life, which then every time you see a change in your life, because we're people helping people to find and follow Jesus, our life change, and there's this overflow into other people's lives, and they go, I don't know what's, every time I hang around you, I'm different, you're different, whatever. It's creating this the place and looking at these to see a clear picture of his purpose. And 99 times out of 100, the purpose that he wants for you is not the one that you thought. And I can tell you that from my own life, from watching other people's lives, it is not one of these things where you're like, that was totally what I thought. Yeah. Talk to anybody in children's ministry. Most of them would go, I never would have thought I'd be back here with these kids. But they'll but God surrendering to him and being back here with these kids has been the best thing for my life. And I know I'm leading them and they're learning something, but I think they're teaching me more. You're amazed at what God can do when you create that space and he paints a picture and you're like, I never saw that Bob Ross painting coming. The last thing, and as we kind of close, is you begin to inviting people into your journey. I'm not saying, and this is why I say, don't get on Facebook when it happens and stand like, you're like, oh, I found my purpose, and you're in the middle of Starbucks, and you're climbing up on a table, and you're like, move everything, and I'm going to take a picture. God gave me this purpose. I'm going to like fast from this stuff, this here, this pretty picture that I staged for 45 minutes. This is what I'm going to do, and I'm going to, like, God is not calling you. Some of you guys thought, I'm not falling. God is not calling you. Like, you need like two other people, an intimate moment where you're able to say, God has led me to this. I just need you to ask me how I'm doing. And I'm going to be honest with you. For some of us, you have never invited anybody into the brokenness of your life. Or if you did, it's been superficial. Hey, can you pray for me? It's unspoken. I have no clue what unspoken means other than I'm not willing to be real with you. And I'm not shaming anybody. I've done this too, but at some point in the middle of our journey in creating space for God and then following him and moving this way, at some point, you and I want to be people helping people find and follow Jesus. I want to have character that is rich. And so I'm going to invite somebody into my journey and I'm going to share with them things that I've never said. But the beauty in a community like this is no one's going to sit there and go, man, that's awful. They're going to go, usually, and me too. I felt that hurt too. There is a beauty in giving things up so that we can be free. You see, we can't stay here. Wherever you find yourself this morning, you can't stay there. God loves you exactly where you're at, whether you are far, you feel far from him or you're close to him, but you and I cannot stay in the place that we find ourselves. But just like we mentioned before, if we desire to be deep in character, in how God designed us, and in that the rhythm of your habits and my habits will change. It's not this, I want that, but nothing will change. That it will change, and it happens when we seek God void of the noise. And every one of these pieces begins to get real quiet. For some of us right now, even that little bit of silence was terrifying. God wants to get into these moments and he wants to tear apart all of the walls and set you free and call you to a depth of character that will help lead every single person that you meet to see the face and love and joy of Jesus. For some of you, he's doing it right now. Would you pray with me?